Hey, Scott Grove here, and I'm going to show you how to make a carved snowflake ornament featured in the December-January issue of Woodcraft Magazine. This is a project you can complete in only a few hours. It's great for those last-minute Christmas gifts. And you can use this technique to make a variety of ornaments, from flat circular ones to turned on the lathe, and even ones with secret compartments.
Ooh.
So here I'm going with a 3-inch blank. What you want to do is decide what size snowflake design. So here I printed out the snowflake design just from the internet, or go to woodcraftmagazine.com and download the pattern they have on there. Here I've scaled them simply in a Word document, a 2-inch, 2.5, and 3-inch design. It gives me a little flexibility when I'm laying that out. You can certainly cut this out of a flat piece of hardwood, but I like to add a little dimension to it and turn it on the lathe. We're going to go this way. So in this case, I'm going to start with a 3-inch square. That'll give me roughly a 3-inch diameter. I'm going to go a little smaller, about 2¾-inch diameter ornament. And we got to cut this out on a bandsaw. So I need to locate the center of this square simply by connecting the corners. And I'm going to draw two circles. First circle is going to be roughly the diameter of the finished ornament. Second, so I'm going to make a tenon. I'm going to glue a tenon on here that'll help chuck it into the lathe. And I want to get this centered. I'm going to pull this in and draw a circle just a little larger than that tenon. I like to glue my tenon on with a piece of paper in between. I use a little white or yellow glue, nice even coat. Put my paper on. This will make it easier to break the tenon off after it's been turned. I'm going to visually press that in place and clamp this on with an A-clamp. You want to be sure when you put the A-clamp on that it doesn't slide around. It has a tendency to do that. And there we go. So we're going to wait about 15 minutes, maybe a half hour. I can chuck this up on a lathe. For the tenon, it's important to use hardwood or a good quality plywood like Baltic birch. You do not want to use MDF. This is what happens when you use MDF. I like to use EasyWood tool products because they're just easy to use. So here's their easy chuck, and their jaws snap in real easy. I like to use their extended jaws. Just keeps the tool away from the chuck head. And they have a speed ring here, so I can now mount my blank on there and get the tendon all the way in. You want to make sure you tighten down both sides of the jaw. Looks pretty good. I'm going to bring in my banjo first. Make sure my tool rest is the right height, right on the center line. That looks good. I'm going to get this going about 1,000, 1,200 RPMs. Just kiss this face to make sure this face is nice and flush here. That's great. I want to mark the diameter that I'm going to bring this down to, which is about 2¾. I could either bring in a tailstock to hold the center and come in perpendicular to the axis to round this off. But on such a narrow piece, I simply like to take a square tool, drive it in that way. I'm going to say outside my line, and that gets me a good thickness. Always turn your lathe off when you're moving your banjo around. I want my ornament to be a little thinner. This is 3/4-inch stock or 4/4-inch material. I think that's a little chunky, so I want to make this about 1/2 inch. Now I have my thickness set. I'm just going to take this face down. The diameter of this, I'm going to set my calipers 2¾. Now I have my diameter set. I'm going to finish this curve. Bring it right down to the point. This is why I like the easy reach jaws, because it keeps my tool away from the chuck. So I can come past and there's no danger of hitting that there. I'm just looking sideways here, just to make sure I have a nice graceful curve, which I think I'm pretty good there. Let's check our diameter with our calipers. Looks like I'm right on. Beautiful. Looks nice. Got a nice smooth cut too. No reason for sanding at this stage of the game. We'll do that after we do our inlay. So you're going to be making two sides of this, and if you want your ornament to be symmetrical, it's always good to work with a little template, give you an idea of that curve. I think I'm pretty good there. So I like to leave my ornament on the jaws, do our carving and use this as a vise. I'm going to take the head, the jaws, right off. In this project, we use yellow glue to glue on the pattern. In the Woodcraft Magazine article, I use spray adhesive. Both of them work just fine. The spray adhesive allows you to remove the pattern with mineral spirits, or I can simply sand or scrape off the one that's glued on with yellow glue. So I'm going to measure the distance of the arc on the face of the ornament. Got about 3 inches here. I want my pattern to be a little smaller. I'm going to go with about the 2 1/4 inch one. At this point, I want to cut it pretty close to the tips. Doesn't have to be perfect. Now, to glue this on, it's certainly going to wrinkle. So what I do is I cut little pleats on either side of the branch of the snowflake. This will help me lay this pattern down nice and flat when I glue it on. So now I'm going to mark roughly the center. And measure the radius of the snowflake and transfer that to my ornament. And this will help me center my snowflake when I glue it in place. I'm going to add a light layer of glue. Spread it on there nice and thin. And visually align my paper. And I'll press down the large sections first. And then these pleats can kind of lay over the top. Using a pencil to burnish it down. Make sure there's no wrinkles. I'm going to wait 5 minutes. Come back and carve that baby. So we're ready to start carving. Some of the things that'll make life a little easier. Obviously, good visor. Woodcraft sells a variety of these. I like this one, it actually has a little light on it. I like the Flex Carve. This is a power carver with a V-bit. Makes the carving go a lot faster. Then I'll go back in and I'll do some cleanup with some very small fine V-gouges. I like to use a rubber mat. That keeps the chuck from moving around. And what I'll do here is carve the main legs of the snowflake first, then I'll go and do the secondary branches, and then I'll come in and I'll do the third level. You want to be sure your V-bit is nice and sharp. I like to use a little diamond sharpening card just to tune up that edge. Something like a sharp tool to make life a little easier. I'm going to take a nice light pass right down the center, and then I can work from the center to the outside lines. So once I have the center cuts, I'm going to work this each edge and just follow that line. Not like that. And I'm going about 1/16 to 3/32 seconds deep. I like to work all the left side of the lines first and then the right side. It just gets a nice rhythm going. Obviously, cutting with the grain, the bit can actually wander a little bit. It'll sort of follow the grain. So I'm using my thumb to help control the sort of left and right action. Try to keep this thing straight. And you can see it actually wandered off this way a little bit. Cutting cross grain, which this cut's going to be, is a lot easier. Now I like Purple Heart because it's a nice tight grain. I like to work with other tight grain woods. Padauk is a nice one, but you can also use any tight grain hardwood. Here's a Padauk one I carved. You want to be careful with open grain wood like wenge or oak, because when you do the inlay, it gets in the grain. Cherry's a nice wood to work with. I love carving cherry. You want to get these lines nice and straight. Now after I got the main leg, I'm going to go into the secondary legs. And again, to get a nice rhythm, I'm going to kind of work one side of the line and then the other. And the branches are so small, I can do it in one cut. And you can see, I don't have to move my arm around. I'm going to keep my chisel in one place and just rotate the chuck. It makes this go fast. And you can see how quickly this flex carver works. If I want to carve this by hand, it's important to think safety first. I'm putting a lot of force and there's a chance that this can jump forward and get into my fingers. So you want to wear a leather glove. And I could carve this by hand. It just goes a lot slower. A little more control, but I'm putting a lot of force there. And I can't stress enough, you need a leather glove. Let's go back to the power carving. I like that a lot better. Now for the little itty bitty branches. Here we go. At this point, I take my ornament out of the EasyWood chuck because I don't want to get any CA glue on my chuck. So now you'll need some thin CA glue and crushed mother of pearl from Easy Inlay. I like to work on a sheet of paper so I can save any excess. This particular mother of pearl is very, very soft and iridescent. It simply rubs into your carving. I'm going to press it in as hard as I can, rubbing across the carvings. Once I have it all done, I'm going to brush off all the excess just with my finger, trying not to dig into the grooves. I can now save my excess. And I simply take CA glue and drip it in the center and let it flow down each leg of the leaf. Make sure you get every single one and let that set up. I don't like to use accelerator at this stage because the accelerator can boil the CA glue. In addition, it makes the CA hard, a lot harder and more difficult to sand off. I like to put a second coat of mother of pearl on because the first coat of CA glue sometimes will wick down or collapse the mother of pearl onto itself and will then be below the surface. So by putting another coat of mother of pearl on, rubbing in the little extra little voids, another application of CA just ensures that I'm at least flush, if not above the surface. So when I sand this flush, we'll have a nice crisp line. An important note, remember to always wear a dust mask when working with wood and mother of pearl. That's really important. Now we could either sand this, or you can use EasyWood Tools negative rake carbide cutter. It's less aggressive. It works very well with wood and sort of plastics, which CA glue is. But in this case, I'm going to just go ahead and sand it. I like to work at a slower speed and in reverse. So it's going the opposite direction that my sander is working on. Let me slow this down a lot. I'm working about 350 RPM. I'm starting with 120 grit, and I work my way up to 600. You want to make sure you get down to wood. Here I have some CA or glue resin left over. I like to go through 6 grits, starting with 120, 180, 240, 320, 400, and 600. I like to wipe it down with alcohol. It cleans the excess dust off and shows me what my design is like. Some cases, you might actually sand through the grooves and you'll have to go back, recarve that one area, and refill it with some other pearl. At this point, we're going to remove the ornament from the tenon, and the fact that I glued on that piece of paper will make this really easy. So after you take the ornament off the tenon, you want to sand the back flush. You can either use a belt sander or simply sheet of paper flat on your bench. Keep in mind, you're going to want to repeat the entire process to make two halves that will go together. So in the two halves, you want to make sure the diameter is exactly the same. You can certainly, if one is a little bigger, by sanding it down, it will reduce the diameter. I got a nice matching pair. At this point, glue these babies together. Again, I want to make sure there's no slippage when I put on an A-clamp. Let that sit to dry. After your glue is set, so if the edges don't line up exactly, you can simply round that edge over. Seamless match. So to complete your project, you just want to apply the finish of your choice. You can use the CA glue, shellac, lacquer, oil, whatever you like. I like to use lacquer, a little quicker. Second coat. Good. If you want to take this ornament project to another level, you can actually add a secret compartment. This is great for a loved one, if you want to add a diamond ring, a coin, or a piece of coal. The way you do this, go through the same processes, but you're going to add some magnets. Here I got rare earth magnets, and the key to this is to make sure you get the polarity right. So I have the two that are stuck together, and I'm going to flip them over and just mark each side with a dot of magic marker. And that will be my face up. I drilled out my blank with a Fausner bit and two Brad bits. I can drop in my magnets and glue them in with some CA glue. Once they're set up, I can go ahead and turn them, and I'm going to have a matching pair of sides. I've actually painted over the surface to hide the magnets and put a little piece of felt in there. It's a great little extra to take this to a whole nother level. If you made one of these for each member of the family, it's going to be a family tradition to come and find your ornament and see what surprises inside. So pick up your copy of Woodcraft Magazine at your local Woodcraft store, or go online at woodcraft.com for your holiday gifts and project supplies.